Now on BBC Four, the power of love and music's political statements alongside fluff, smooth jazz and a whole lot of hair. It's Top of the Pops, the story of 1984.
This program's so good, I want to eat it.
...1984, and Top of the Pops is in its 80s pomp.
There's never been a more gay time in pop than 1984.
High energy, a new exultant sound from the gay club scene, hit the charts.
They just said Searching, Hazeldene, I mean, it was huge.
Advances in technology led to the rise of the one-man band.
I was always acutely aware of the fact that I hadn't got a clue what I was doing.
I think I got addicted to the fear.
And a new jazz age saw the show come over all horny.
I said that we were a bit like if Frank Sinatra was in The Clash.
Pop had never been so big, so bold, and so brash.
She totally owned the stage. It's amazing to see somebody with such confidence.
We've got to have a good time, because it all could end tomorrow. We've got to go down swinging.
Even briefly becoming top of the Europops.
Good music from Germany.
Oh, I don't know.
Doesn't exist.
It's the year of big hair and big statements.
I thought Nelson would be so happy in his cell to know that Top of the Pops had provided balloons.
And the class of 84 surprised us all by setting aside their rivalries and taking over the Christmas Top of the Pops like one big, concerned but happy family.
This was a moment of celebration that we'd kind of done this. We'd pulled this off.
At the third stroke, it will be 9:59.
And 20 seconds.
As the speaking clock changed sex in 1984, after nearly 50 years as a woman, it was clear that the old certainties were shifting. Industrial Britain was struggling to come to terms with the Thatcherite revolution. Society was bitterly divided, and the resulting clashes were ugly. Top of the Pops was also caught between the old and the new. It began the year by honouring its past, but also embracing a brave new world.
Well, hello, fans. Now, you might think what we've got here is some kind of tribute to Mike Reed, but actually, what we're celebrating is the 20th anniversary of Top of the Pops.
And I think we really look fab gear.
Yeah, there is that. This is very 1984, though, this. Frankie Goes to Hollywood.
Take it away, boys!
With the top 30 newly expanded to the top 40, Top of the Pops producer Michael Hurl took a punt on a new entry at number 35 by a band causing ripples with their debut single.
To be honest, that would have done me. That would have been the goal achieved, that we got a single and it got into the charts and we're on Top of the Pops. Relax.
And on a historic anniversary show, you want it to look your best.
So we all legged it down to Moss Bros, didn't we? And all
yeah,
hired
Moss
suits.
Bros in Covent Garden. Fitted up, looking like absolute lemons.
Dickie Bell the lot.
I remember Holly came with no clothes. He wore a leather jacket that sadly was my leather jacket. And looking back, why I possibly would have wanted to buy a jacket with about 40 zips in, I do not know. But it suited him better than it suited me.
I remember watching it and thinking, they look great, you know? They look so good and it works so well with the record.
Woo! Relax's sound was the work of the man said to have invented the 80s, producer Trevor Horn.
I was channeling them, you know. They told me very early on, we want to be like a cross between Kiss meets Donna Summer.
It took many hours of experimenting before hitting on the sound he wanted for the record.
So I had this piano going ding, 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 ding. And then we got this device that locked the drum machine to it. Switching to the chorus pattern, which went sort of dig, 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 with a whole load of percussion. I heard that change. It was like, this, we've got something here.
I remember hearing it and just think, that's it all day long.
Despite the song's orgasmic content and the band's reputation for controversy, or perhaps because of it, when Relax finally crept into the charts, Michael Hurl was keen on one condition.
We got a pretty formal letter from Top of the Pops saying it was important that the Frankies behaved themselves so that he couldn't have any chained up women or anything like that. I thought, great, that's so cool. All they have to do now is turn up and be like good boys, you know?
Michael Hurl saw that the record was going to be huge. He didn't have a problem with the lyrics at the time. And you used to have to submit lyrics along with the records and everything else for directors to use, etc., whatever. So they all had a copy of the lyrics, so they knew exactly what they were getting themselves into.
Now, I always remember the next morning, Dave Robinson, who was running Ireland at the time, phoned me up and said, you're not going to believe it, we just sold 55,000 units. It's gone mad. And I knew, I thought, I know it's going to go even madder. I can feel it.
Top of the Pops had played its part in propelling Relax up the charts. But less than a week later, this happened.
We used to repeat the chart on a Wednesday morning. I needed getting up to 9 o'clock, and I was trying to squeeze everything in. Adrian John was the only one in the studio with me. But we just didn't have time to squeeze them all in. And I remember Adrian saying, have you seen the sleeve of this? And I said, well, if I'm going to drop something, I'll drop this.
Things quickly snowballed.
I was trying to Wars Radio 1, and I remember ringing up ZTT and saying, look, they've banned it. They've actually banned it.
We were in ZTT's offices when we found out it was banned, and champagne corks were popped.
All it did was put it into turbo drive.
As Relax stormed up the charts, the BBC ban left Top of the Pops with a Frankie-shaped hole.
Here at number one, Frankie Goes to Hollywood, Relax. And that's it for this week. Hope you enjoyed the show. The Rhythm Pals got to make their way back to Radio 1.
It's all about who is number one. It's kind of like a Game of Thrones, and we want to see who's going to be crowned. And Frankie deserved to be crowned. So it was an enormous letdown for everyone.
To have a number one at Top of the Pops, you can't really complain that you're not going to get the chance to perform it. Because you know you're off and running now, we're off.
This is Heaven, one of London's newest and smartest discos.
The pumping beat of Relax reflected a style of electronic dance music known as high energy that had been popular in gay clubs such as Heaven for several years. Now, in 1984, high energy entered the mainstream.
'70s, it was a joyous four on the floor up sound. High energy was the next logical evolution. I'm in the It was disco, but with electronic beat. It was disco for the 80s, not the 70s.
Ian Levine had been the resident DJ at Heaven since it opened in 1979. Now, 5 years on, he teamed up again with Evelyn Thomas, an American singer he'd worked with in the 70s, to capture the new club sound.
I sat down with my co-producer and said, we're going to write a song called High Energy as an anthem to the music, which we're playing at Heaven. So we wrote this song called High Energy. It took 1 hour to write. It took 1 hour to sing it, which came in from America. And I just knew there and then it was a hit.
To Top of the Pops viewers, something might have sounded oddly familiar about the song.
I think it was a track called High Energy that nicked ding 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 the gated keyboard part that I did.
I must confess I'd heard Relax as a pre-release and liked it so much it certainly influenced me when I made High Energy. But what you may never know, and no one has realised, is that the beat of High Energy is in the Navy. It's we want you, we want you, we want you for a new recruit. Bam, 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 bam.
High energy, yeah, your love is lifting me, lifting me high, energy,
high energy tunes were usually sung by a female diva, but we had our own queen of high energy.
If I should lose you now.
Hazel Dean first appeared on the BBC in A Song for Europe in 1976.
I used to sing in bands, and Ian Anthony Stevens, who wrote and produced Searching, tracked me down, and he played the track. And because when I heard that track, it was just so different from anything else that I'd heard.
Recorded in spring 1983, Searching quickly became a huge club hit, reaching number one in the high energy charts.
That track took me into the gay clubs, but I didn't know that there were gay charts. I had no idea.
In 1984, a hit in the gay charts stood a good chance of mainstream success. And that spring, Searching went overground into the top 40.
OK, her first time on Top of the Pops. The record's been out a year. It's about time it's a hit, and now it is for Hazel Dean. It's called Searching.
Searching, I'm looking for love.
Top of the Pops couldn't resist the urge to replicate the atmosphere of a sweaty gay night spot in Television Centre. Cue two cute male dancers and a bit of a light show.
There was a breakdown in the middle of the song. It was very sort of clubby. There was the little synth drums, you know, do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do, and the hand claps. The old strobe lighting would come on and I did my little dance with the boys. Looked like a disco, I suppose.
Searching, looking for love.
2 weeks later, Hazel was back to continue her search.
It was shot live, and so the camera kind of came off of me. It went on the boy, and he was twirling his little thing round, and it gets it all around his head. There's nothing I can do about it because it's live.
The pulsating beat of High Energy was one of the sounds of the year. And for now, clubbers at Heaven continue to party like it was 1984.
People wanted happy music in 1984. I think High Energy reflected this. It gave people a chance to take off their shirts and dance and just enjoy themselves and dance till dawn, literally.
I think it was the last hurrah of an era where people felt they could be sexually as free as they were at that particular time.
This new freedom could still be celebrated in gay culture in a largely pre-AIDS Britain, but not by gay pop stars, few of whom were out.
Rock star Elton John was married in Australia this morning. His bride was a German recording studio engineer, Renata Blaul.
There's never been a more gay time in pop than 1984, although a lot of artists are being very ambiguous, very cagey about whether they're gay or not.
Many of the biggest names in pop that year would later come out as gay. But in 84, they feared this might mean commercial suicide.
There was huge pressure on artists not to be open about their sexuality. Let's call a spade, the record companies didn't want them to.
And here making their Top of the Pops debut are Bronski Beat performing live, Small Town Boy.
But there was one band in the charts and on Top of the Pops in May who were unapologetically out, proud, and singing live.
To yourself, to yourself.
Small Town Boy was probably the first overtly gay piece of propaganda ever on Top of the Pops. And I think that makes it a piece of history. And it spoke to a generation of gay people up and down the country.
Bronski Beat's frankness about their sexuality was still the exception rather than the rule.
Other artists were very, very wary of Jimmy and of each other, not just of Jimmy. There was always this fear that somehow or other it might infect them and infect their careers.
Bronski Beat themselves had no such qualms, as the video for Small Town Boy demonstrated.
Bronski Beat came out as an in-your-face gay group. Like us or hate us, we're here and we're queer. That's what it was. Bronski Beat suffered no fools.
We sing about things that emotionally sort of like move us, that emotionally stimulate us. Yeah. Everybody's entitled to do that. It just so happens that we're three gay men who are doing that.
Top of the Pops made Bronski Beat a pop group, and Top of the Pops made them available and accessible and sold them to a whole generation, gay, straight, whatever.
Top of the Pops' selling power had previously established Duran Duran, Culture Club, Spandau Ballet and Wham as the big four of British pop. By 1984, they'd gone global and were in
around in little shorts as much as they used to. George Michael was a big Motown fan, and this is coming through here. Duran Duran have become a stadium band. And Spandau Ballet, they've lost their way. The songs they're recording now are not memorable. Culture Club? They're losing their way a little too. It's
a miracle, it's a miracle. International success had taken its toll on the big four bands. And advances in recording technology now threatened bands themselves with obsolescence.
I started off doing the one-man electronic band because I couldn't find any musicians around to work with at the time. I thought, well, I want to use the technology of the time, and I want to write songs that are quite philosophically based. In a sense, New Song was like my manifesto.
Don't For his Top of the Pops debut the previous year, one-man band Howard Jones brought along his friend Jed to get his message across.
Jed was really fascinating to people, but I was incredibly nervous. And when I watch it back, you don't really see that, but underneath the surface, there was sheer terror going on. And if you watch me, I'm like chewing gum. I didn't have any gum in my mouth. It was like I had a nervous tic to try and calm myself down. And then what happened was that I think I got addicted to the fear.
At number 12, Howard Jones, Hide and Seek.
In 1984, almost all acts on Top of the Pops still mimed. So Howard ramped up that fear factor by playing and singing live.
I've always been looking for those challenges that sort of push you a little bit further to take a risk. So I was really, really up for doing that. But I remember getting a bit lost in the dry ice a few times. With its ups and its downs. It's rain and it's sun. She decided that her work it was done. Time to have fun. That was the most enjoyable Top of the Pops for me because of the sheer adrenaline going through me. Hope you find it. Hope you find me. You.
Howard Jones wasn't the only solo act out of their comfort zone on Top of the Pops in 1984.
It was utterly terrifying. You know, I'm a guitar player and I've spent the last 5 years playing guitar and I play guitar in the studio, so obviously I'm going to go on television with a keyboard.
Exposed and alone on the Top of the Pop stage, with no mic and only a haircut for company, what you choose to wear can make a lasting impression. I got it bad.
You don't know how bad you got it. Don't talk to me about that snood. It kind of took on a life of its own, and it's literally been around my neck for my entire career. I could easily blame my stylist, but the buck stopped with me, really, because I did stand in front of that mirror and go, yeah, I'm going to go on national television looking like that. That's fine.
Two weeks later, Nick was back. And this time, the show had a trick up its sleeve.
I think the second time I did it, the production people kind of realised that actually there was nothing going on here. There's no great moves or anything. And so they stuck the video of the song behind me and kept cutting between it. You must be joking. You don't know anything about it. You got no problem. I can understand why they did that, yeah. The heat is stifling, burning
me up from the inside. Nick Kershaw and Howard Jones were the perfect pop packages for 1984. Big hair, fancy clothes, and a handful of catchy tunes. But alongside High Energy, another underground club scene burst into the charts that year, combining jazz cool and old-fashioned authenticity.
With the Wild Club, it was a reaction against all the kind of the rather soulless synth pop of the time. And I just wanted to do a club where people could dance, where they could listen to music. It was like a hybrid of Latin, funk and jazz.
Early pioneers of this sound and look were Chris Sullivan's band Blue Rondo a la Turk. And Top of the Pops would inadvertently play a role in this flourishing scene.
In a queer kind of way, without the Top of the Pops, it wouldn't have been a Wild Club. Because we were going to go on Top of the Pops one day and we were the most played record on Radio 1. We were all ready, we got there, yeah, boys, you're on, don't worry, get all our stuff, you know, like dance routines, the splits, the backdrops. All ready for it the day before when he was just, sorry, you've lost out to Ken Dodd. Hold my hand if you're yellow, black or white. And they were so apologetic.
And they said, if you stay where you are, you're on next week. And we went down one place, and that was it. If I'd have gone on Top of the Pops, undoubtedly we would have gone on to bigger success. And undoubtedly I wouldn't have started the Wank Club, because I did that because I was skint.
But out of that same scene emerged a singer who became one of the voices and faces of 1984. Sade first caught the eye as a backing vocalist with jazz funk group Pride.
You know, I used to hang out with Sade. She lived in this squat and she had all these records, and I used to listen to the records. We used to think, oh, we should try and write our own songs, like just little jazzy, soul-y things.
The rules for pop success in 1984 were the same, whatever your sound. You needed a good image and a determination to succeed.
We weren't accomplished songwriters or musicians. I think if any of us had been 10% better, it would have been horrible.
She's making her debut with Your Love Is King. This is Sade.
When Sade and her new band made their Top of the Pops debut in March, the Wag Club ethos of real instruments and understatement sounded unlike much else in the charts at the time.
Your love is king, crown you in my heart. Your love is king, never need to part. Your kisses ring.
First time being on Top of the Pops, I just remember looking at the audience and them being slightly confused as to how to dance to us. You know, because it was kind of slow and it was like in 6/8 kind of time signature, and they weren't quite sure.
Even the Top of the Pops team were put in a tizz by Sade.
The first time seeing our name on the countdown, and it said, no, Sade, Your Love Is King, and it said Slade.
Sade, Your Love Is King, and chart entry at 37.
Wow. Obviously, I love Slade, but it was a bit, you know.
Did you like the way we deliberately misspelt Sade there? OK, let's get back to the charts.
Get out, you lazy bed. Get up. Suddenly, jazz was king. Step forward, Matt Bianco, a more poppy offshoot of Blue Rondo a la Turk. Get out, you lazy bed. An Animal Nightlife added an air of sophistication.
I mean, it was kind of crazy, really, when you think about how much success came out of that scene. We were reflecting what we saw when we went out clubbing and the friends that we had, really, in the real life, in the real world. You know, Mushadi, it just went stratospheric.
By September, and their second single, everyone knew who Sade was.
Sade came at a time when a lot of people were ready to embrace jazz music, and she was the perfect person to introduce it.
I love the fact that it was, you know, someone from our scene, and it was a black woman being elevated, and she did it all in her own terms. There was no one who sounded like her, and I think that's where she hit, you know, she hit the ball out of the park.
Despite its hip beginnings, the tasteful sound of jazz pop would quickly come to be associated with 80s consumerism, the cocktail years.
There was a lot of places like cocktail bars that people used to go out, and, you know, we got criticised, and, oh, it's cocktail lounge music or whatever. But, you know, I'm not going to really apologise for that, for being sophisticated.
What made Top of the Pops performances like Sade's look more dynamic in 1984 was the show's increasing use of handheld cameras for close-ups. But for the cameraman, it was an operation that didn't always go smoothly.
Although these portable cameras could get to all sorts of interesting places, when they first came out in those early days, they tended to have very narrow angle lenses on them. And that means when you move around with a narrow angle lens, every wobble, every shake really shows up. You tend to see quite a lot of those kind of very sort of close, quite ugly shots sometimes. They're low angle because someone's standing on the ground looking up. It all becomes then about seeing the roof behind them. And it's interesting, in the 80s, you've got those big banks of light starting to appear. The lights were burning, burning hot. I mean, the heat that came out of those lights. If you stood on one of those stages with all those lights above you, your head was being grilled, basically.
The use of portable cameras allowed viewers to get up close and personal with performers on the show.
If a performer like Cyndi Lauper came along and wanted to be able to carry off a slightly more flamboyant performance, we just had to go with it.
During the first set of rehearsals, Michael spotted that she was going to be a great performer. And as a result, he gave her not only one stage, but two stages and the gantry to work with.
Cyndi Lauper really goes for it with her performance. She runs up and down the scaffolding, she's playing drums on the scaffolding. She is kooky. She's grabbing people in the audience and making them dance with her. She's giving it all she's got.
In June 1984, Richard Branson's Virgin Atlantic began a service between London and New York. And if the Big Four were part of the second British invasion of the States, a new wave of US stars were coming the other way, including Madonna. And her performance impressed the competition.
I do remember Madonna on that show because there'd been a lot of talk about her, and I think it was quite a big thing that she was actually over. But she totally owned the stage. She was all over the stage. She was skipping around it and all sorts. It's amazing to see somebody with such confidence.
What you need to look for, really, is she's wearing those provocative rosaries and crucifixes around her neck while she's singing like a virgin. So this was a glimpse of things to come.
For young girls watching Top of the Pops, Madonna and Cyndi Lauper offered themselves as brash new role models. Unconventional, a bit shocking, but plainly having a good time. Unlike Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher, who came under fire from the wives of striking miners.
One egg hit Mrs. Thatcher squarely on the chest. More eggs and also tomatoes, ice cream and butter rained down on her entourage.
It's a lot.
It's a lot.
Like life.
As the year wore on, the miners' strike, which began that spring, saw communities torn apart amidst increasingly violent confrontations.
I think it totally and utterly false to cast a slur on the police for the superb way in which they have handled this dispute.
One television series caught the spirit of these troubled times, mixing up comedy, pop, and anarchy.
Yeah, I'm not into violence, Rick, but I'm really good at special faces.
Oh, come here.
And a hippie.
Neil, how are you giving that back?
Culturally, I think it was quite a shock, the young ones. I don't think anything like that had ever been seen before. Not sure if anything like that's been seen since, actually.
What are we going to do?
pop music can save us now!
We had the bands in The Young Ones. It didn't seem that big a leap, one of the characters from The Young Ones on Top of the Pops.
Hello, Shoes. I'm sorry, but I'm going to have to stand on you again. Oh, no. Where am I? Oh, no, I must be on Top of the Pops. Heavy. What now?
I looked in the sky where an elephant's eye was looking at me from a bubble gun.
The singing was mimed, but there was talking in it. So I was partially miming and partially not miming. We made sure in the speaking bit that we referenced a lot of other acts who were in the charts at the time.
Listen to the lyrics, Paul Weller!
Which is funny at the time. It doesn't seem so funny now.
It just wasn't real with one.
I think it's fascinating when you get someone like Nigel Planer coming into the studio because, of course, they're going to be interested, if it's a comedy song, in making sure that you're on them when the line's being spoken and that you're going to get the comedy.
Oh, no! What's happening?
There was a traditional Top of the Pop shot, the person singing, and the camera comes round, dollying round like that. Then they cut to another one.
I am on Top of the Pops!
But of course, in a narrative sketch, you've got to set something up and pay it off.
I'm in the bath with my shoes on, right? Because it won't make any difference.
And so we wrote a different camera script for them. So it was a little bit challenging to say, no, you must be on my face when I hit myself in the head with the microphone. You don't miss, don't be round the back here.
Hang on.
It was fun breaking the fourth wall and talking to the audience and making them laugh, and, you know, it kind of ruined Top of the Pops, we hope.
Back in the real world, laughter was in short supply in the Cold War Britain of 84. So, having courted controversy with sex on Relax, Frankie Goes to Hollywood now turned their sights on war.
Frankie's didn't have any obvious material for a second single. They had Two Tribes, but their original version of Two Tribes was quite random and quite sort of indie. And the second single, when you've had a massive single, if you don't get the second single away, you're dead meat.
This bit's good.
I remember walking into Studio 2 at Psalm, and Trevor said, well, I've had to play around with a few bits, have a listen to this and put it onto the bigs, put it on number 11, as they say, and, you know, blew us away.
When Two Tribes crashed straight in at number one and remained there for much of the summer, Michael Hurl was finally able to welcome Frankie back to Top of the Pops with open arms.
Now, at last, it's their time to get crowned. 9 times in a row. And Michael Hurl gives them this platform because he owes it to them, frankly.
With Two Tribes looking indomitable at number one, its nearest challenger became their own song, Relax, which had risen up the charts again to reach number two. And Michael Hurl got more than he bargained for when Frankie made their 5th live appearance on the show, brandishing firearms.
We'd done it a few times, so we're a bit cheeky and a bit leery now. And it was a live show. And when we did the dress rehearsals, we were saying...
Don't pull
the guns out. But it was only when the thing was live that... We pulled out these replica guns. And our manager was watching it in the gallery with Michael Hurl, and he's gone, this is brilliant, because I didn't know they were going to do it. He's in the clear. There's nothing he can do about it, but he's just got a great bit of telly there. Like, these nutters have just pulled guns out.
The Frankie propaganda machine was now an unstoppable force, and their secret weapon was the T-shirt.
I think it was actually Paul Rutherford's idea to go, why can't we have some T-shirts made like these Cat and Hamlet ones? Was the first one was the Pershing one, wasn't it? I was wondering,
and one young lady with a message?
But being the biggest band in Britain brought intense tabloid scrutiny.
That was the performance where, at the beginning, Holly's seen reading The Sun, and the Sun would doorstep in his parents about his sexuality. So he wasn't pleased.
When you hear the air attack warning, you and your family must take cover.
Let's go! To round it off, Holly showed it wasn't only girls who wanted to have fun.
And now we have the handheld cameras coming into their own. And it's all a little bit wobbly, but it's all a bit risque and it's all a little bit fun.
It was a nightmare for Michael Hurl. And I remember him being less than pleased, but the end performance was one of the classic Top of the Pops performances.
Holly's inspired Pied Piper walkabout led Top of the Pops in a new direction of mildly chaotic spontaneity.
We've got to have a good time because it all could end tomorrow. We're in the middle of a nuclear holocaust, maybe. We've got to go down swinging.
Russians are already modernising their short-range nuclear weapons in Eastern Europe, and the experts reckon they may speed this up as soon as any new American missiles arrive.
The threat of nuclear war had intensified across Europe by 1984. Nowhere was that felt more than in Berlin.
I think the feeling in Berlin at the time was like dancing on the volcano.
Out of that volcano floated an idea for a song.
Carlo Cargas, the guitar player, showed me the lyrics. 99 Luftballons. Hast du etwas Zeit für mich? Sehe ich ein Lied für dich von 99 Luftballons auf ihrem Weg zum Horizont. I read the lyrics and I was like blown away in the same second, because it was so goosebumping. And then Carlo played the riff, like, and I was like, kidding me, what's going on here?
And then when I came to the rehearsal studio, I said, I have this great new melody, and I have this great new part, but I don't know how shall we put this together? And then our drummer, Rolf, he said, I just do da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, wham. And I said, yeah.
UK, traditionally, foreign language singles were very, very difficult to promote.
Back in 1983, Top of the Pops included the song in one of their odd forays into the European charts.
And at number two, 99 Luftballons, whatever they may be, that's Nana.
As it was so successful in Europe, we asked the publishers to
Songs like 99 Red Balloons with a Message were proving popular in 1984, and Michael Hurl had no problem with featuring them on Top of the Pops. Whether it's Bananarama protesting the political situation in Northern Ireland, or Culture Club stating the obvious. But one song in 1984 combined a direct political plea with a ludicrously catchy tune and rhythm.
Like everyone else, I'd never heard of Nelson Mandela, so I went up to this concert and, you know, it was celebrating his birthday. They had a lot of leaflets about him, and obviously I read up about him and found out a lot more about him, and that's where I got the idea to put these lyrics to this tune that I'd already been working on.
Jerry had an idea for the chorus. Free Nelson Mandela. That's what he came in with. And so we started working on it from there.
It had a very simple melody. I mean, if I can sing it, then just about anybody can sing it.
For the recording session, Jerry Dammers assembled a collective of like-minded musicians.
Elvis Costello was brought in, Dave Wakelin, Limbo Golding from the Specials. That idea of getting a lot of different people together on one record, you know, I don't think there'd been many, but, you know, examples, if any, of that.
In 1984, protesting against the injustices of the South African apartheid system was an increasingly popular cause in Britain. But the BBC had to be seen to tread a careful line when it came to overtly political sentiments. The infectious groove of Free Nelson Mandela, however, meant no radio station could resist it.
If more people had known who Nelson Mandela was, it might never have got played on the BBC, because I don't think people at first realised what we were singing about. So it's like a sort of Trojan horse.
When the single charted, Top of the Pops couldn't resist it either.
When you go on Top of the Pops, you give a big performance, you know, you do the very best you can, but it didn't mean that it was going to do really well. But when we were on the second time, it was a bit more triumphant.
I remember the balloons. I thought how wonderful Nelson would be, so happy in his cell to know that Top of the Pops had provided balloons.
The success of Free Nelson Mandela and the momentum it added to the anti-apartheid movement was proof that if musicians pulled together, they could make a difference.
In terms of spreading far and wide the notion of who Nelson Mandela was and reminding people that apartheid was still happening and that people were still suffering, I think, yes, very much, it made a difference in that respect.
It actually achieved more than the Specials, dare I say it. And I think probably Bob Geldof was aware of the record.
I have one of those things.
So I think it had a bit of a knock-on effect, that idea of people coming together on one record for a cause, you know.
I was just watching that Ethiopian thing. I think this is gross after coming out after seeing that.
Oh, yeah.
I'm serious.
dawn, and as the sun breaks through the piercing chill of night on the plain outside Coram, it lights up a biblical famine, now in the 20th century.
No one who saw Michael Burke's report from Ethiopia in October 1984 would ever forget it. Here was a humanitarian cause that would bring together the pop world on an unprecedented scale.
Bob wanted to do something but didn't feel that he was in a position to do it, and they asked if I would help out. We met up a couple of days later and came up with the basic concept, the idea of, you know, putting together a Christmas song.
It's Christmas time. There's no need to be afraid. At Christmas time.
I was told that Bob Geldof wants to speak to me, and he filled me in basically on what he'd seen on TV. And he asked me if I was up for doing it, and we said we'll make time.
With no time for egos, the class of 84 pulled out all the stops. And one performance in particular stood out.
I'd been aware of U2, right, but I'd never really seen him. And when he comes in with that line, thank God, it's us, and say, I mean, the heads on the back of your neck stand up. Well, tonight, thank God it's them
instead of you. Bono, of course, just decided at that split second to just move up a gear and jump up the octave, which was just magnificent, and it kind of made the record.
A little over a week after being recorded, the Band-Aid single was mixed, pressed, and in the shops. But even before its release, Top of the Pops was playing its part in supporting the cause.
Bob Geldof's got a cardboard box with him, and it's full of T-shirts. He just says, look, we're trying to get everybody to wear these Feed the World T-shirts. You up for it? I said, yeah, no problem at all.
Well, it looked better than the snood, Nick. Bob Geldof had little trouble persuading the acts to wear them. But not everything went so smoothly. Under Top of the Pops rules, no record could be played on the show until it had charted, not even a charity one. So BBC One controller Michael Grade shifted the Thursday schedule by 5 minutes to create a spot before Top of the Pops to show the Band-Aid video for the very first time. And it was introduced by our very own superstar.
It would be wonderful if you could all buy copies of this record over the next period through Christmas. If you can't afford them, club together with somebody else to buy a copy. You know that the money will go to the Ethiopians. Thank you.
With The Power of Love, Frankie Goes to Hollywood became the first band since Gerry and the Pacemakers to see their first three singles go to number one. But it didn't make it to Christmas. Last Christmas. Not to reach the top spot.
To introduce Britain's best-selling record this week and also the fastest-selling record ever. It's Band-Aid and Do They Know It's Christmas. Till next week.
Do They Know It's Christmas swept everyone else aside. And Michael Hurl had ambitious plans for the Christmas show. For the finale of a momentous year in pop, for a few minutes that Christmas day, a divided Britain forgot its trouble. But the Pops showed its continued importance as a unifying force in British culture.
There was a sense that we could relax a little bit now the record's been made, and we knew that it was doing its job. And I suppose it was Christmas by this point, and we had a chance to think, you know, we've managed to do something great with what we have to offer.
Was kind of fun, you know. Everything up until that point had been really quite po-faced. It was quite serious, you know. And this was a kind of a moment of celebration that we kind of done this. We'd pulled this off somehow, you know.
Bob Geldof and Midge Ure originally hoped to raise £72,000 for famine relief with the Band Aid single. With over 3 million copies eventually sold, the final figure was £8 million. And 1985 saw the Band Aid project grow into Live Aid, the biggest televised concert the world had seen. Also in 1985, Top of the Pops saw its first non-white presenter.
Apogee of Dixie Beach. Thanks, Mike. I've been laying in the sun in anticipation.
And producers Stock, Aitken and Waterman commandeered High Energy to claim their first number one, offering the sound of things to come.
You may have gathered that. I hope you've enjoyed yourselves. Good night.